is today. Man is a provider. The word of God is absolutely clear. One of the big jobs man was given and was made harder in chapter 3 of the book of Genesis is working with his own hands in order to provide for his family. So that is our topic today. Man as a provider. And I will be emphasizing the fact that as a man, you are not expected to be the recipient of your wife's hard work. You are supposed to be working yourself. Because right in the book of Genesis, the Bible says the wife is a helper. Am I right? Not surely. If most of the work has been done by the woman, then you become the helper. For you to be the man God wants you to be, you must take responsibility to provide for your family. However, and I want to say it right at the beginning, for the woman to become a helper, it means it's okay for women to work. It's okay for women to get a salary because they are adding to what the man has already produced. You know, sometimes we argue that women in traditionally were not working, which is a lie. I grew up with my mother was totally literate. But I still remember with her, my younger brothers, she would work in the garden, keep the baby ahead. And when she reaches there, the baby steps ahead. When she reaches, did your mother do something like that? In other words, the people we see were not working, were working very hard. They never had house girls, they didn't have house girls. They themselves were the house girls, and they made sure they provided. The father's job, they have made the school fees, but the mothers had worked, provided the food. Am I right? So you need to understand the way the men today are sometimes becoming kitwagumu because they have a salary. It's a contradiction. Even our kind of mother was the one providing all the food the man was eating, but she never became kitwagumu. Am I right? So it's something that we do. Of course, I'm talking the wrong way, because that's for women. But I want you to understand that there is nothing traditionally or in the Bible that says because the man is a provider, the wife is not doing work. Are we together? But he needs to understand she's helping. However, having said that, I also want to add, because salaries are not within your control, it is possible for the helper to get more money. Because you see, we left my Bible as a bachelor, or not university. We got married. This was after 9 years in marriage. We got married in 79. Now, but it depends on who is working well. Salaries are increased differently. But if he ends up earning more than me, it should not be in a trap to the marriage. Why? Because she's still a helper. I'm not complicating. The critical thing is whether I'm doing my best. I'm working hard. As long as I'm working hard, even if I get more money, I'm still the head of the family. I'm not complicating. Because the money is together. We're not having separate monies. If the money is one, I need to understand in Christianity, economics in a family is like in communism. In communism, they say, give, produce according to your ability, use according to your need. Let me repeat. Produce according to your ability, use according. That's Christian marriage. In Christian marriage, the wife produces to her ability, the man produces to her ability. Then they put the money together. They start using according to their need. In other words, you don't start saying, oh yeah, I brought 10,000, we brought 15, now my dress will be more expensive. No. Once the money is together, you now do budgeting, and I'll be talking about it in a minute. And if the wife's dress is more expensive, it doesn't matter, because now we are all discussing who produced. We are discussing who is going to choose. Am I clear? That in a Christian marriage, you produce according to your ability, use according to your need. So therefore, there cannot be any trouble. There cannot be any trouble once that is fully understood. So I thought I needed to establish that right at the beginning. But it's a very long topic. In fact, we could have taken the whole week on this topic. So let's run through it. Let me explain. Part of the problems we have in families on money is because of our attitude to money. We have wrong attitudes to money, and that's what really gives us trouble as we deal with money in our families, because of wrong attitude. While that attitude is wrong, the behavior will also be very wrong. Let me read Genesis chapter 2, verse 18 to 24. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united with his wife, and they shall become one flesh. The man and his wife were both naked and felt no shame. I told you that we'll keep reading this because it's the definition of marriage. I want to give the beliefs about money by a Christian couple. The beliefs about money by a Christian couple that will determine the behavior. The first thing I notice in this original marriage, which I've been emphasizing throughout the week, is that a man will leave his father. So the first principle of a Christian marriage is that you must not depend on your father. So you have left him. So you need to be very careful, because whoever pays the piper determines the tune. So the first thing you need to deal with as a principle of economics in a family is that you must stop relying on your father. It doesn't make sense for you to marry a girl, then you rely on pocket money from your father. Because as soon as your father is the one providing, he requires certain things. He might even require you give the goat. Now if you don't, he stops the tap. See what I'm talking about? Because you need to understand that you should not get married before you are ready to look after your wife. That does not mean you get rich. You can marry a girl as long as you have enough money for her food and your food. Even if you only one plate, then you can eat in a juicy roaster. She eats first, you eat second. But are you relying on somebody else's money? That's what it's about. That even a Christian man, you do not depend on your father. You depend on God. How do you do? So that first principle. A lot of people, because they are married, they have not left their parents financially. The marriage are having trouble because of the strings being pulled from home. Some of us, the partner is not actually producing, giving money regularly. But he has promised to divide the land and give. What happens? Every time he tells you to do something, when you don't do it, he says, "Man, you can't have money. You know, I'm not yet divided back." Even if your wife has just given back to a baby, and she said, "You're in hell," and your father calls, and you remember the land, you run. You abandon your wife. Do those things happen? You need to understand you are not having a Christian marriage. In a Christian marriage, you do not look forward to your father give you anything. Because God has the ability to give you enough. If your father decides to disinherit you, you'll still survive, because you don't depend on him, you depend on God. Number two, if your father decides to give you money, when you have your own money and you know how to look after it, you'll be able to cope with it. Am I right? So you start your family on the assumption you are depending on God in your two hands or four hands. So it doesn't matter whether your father gives you inheritance or not. And just in case you need to keep talking theory, I come from Nyanda. I get very offended every time I hear that Kenyatta gave us land. It's not true. In 1963, Kenyatta in the original government, the Madaraka, to agree with Wazungus that they were going to move out of Nyanda and buy land in Nakuru and every other part of the Rift Valley. Nyandarua was now hired into certain province. But then we were told, for us to get land, we had to sign papers or loan. So my parents signed a loan, that a year ago, which those who never paid, their land was taken again by the Bureau of Settlement. So the right words, Kenyatta did not give us land. Kenyatta facilitated us to get money from the bank, from the Bureau of Settlement. Which is also good, because my parents would never have been able to raise the money to buy, we have 10 acres. There's no way my parents would have raised the money. But they raised a deposit and they started paying. But because we, the children, were in school, they were not paid regularly. And it was a very crazy thing because every 6 months you will get a statement. If you didn't pay the previous one, there will be interest on this one. Then there was interest on interest on interest. From the original one we took, we really paid a lot of money. When I left university, just for 40 years ago, my first thing, like other men, I went straight to the Bible of Settlement and attached my salary. And then my salary was deducted until Settlement called me to say you are overpaid. Actually, they returned money back to me. Because I knew this is not our land until I paid the loan. And I can't blame my parents for not paying the loan. They were paying my school fees. I'm not going to take them. Do you know something? Because my uncle, the first two died. The first two died earlier. When they died, like my sister was a nursing teacher when she died, I became the acting first one. So the ones below me, I guess, since they can see a problem about the land, they'll start thinking I'll take it. So I went to my mother and told her, I do not intend to do that. I went here about 6 kilometers from our home, bought another 8 acres, so that my mother, my father then had died, my mother can see I have no intention to get the land. When it took a bit longer, I went back to my mother and said, no, you are getting more. Subdivide the land and give your sons. Give your children, but don't give them. See, when you already know I have another land, it's not fair for me to be fighting over a small piece of land when God has given me another one. So they went to the landlord. In the landlord, they said, it can't happen. You have another son in Nairobi, and you can't say his name. Do you know I was ordered? I had to ask permission from Shem to drive to Jabin, to the chief who was representing the landlord, to convince him that it's not my mother refusing to give me land, it's me who is not willing to take it. And I signed. I'm getting the point. And so I never got any land from my mother. My friend, we have seen people fighting, killing each other for their father's land. What kind of business is that? Why can't you ask God to give you enough money to have your own land? So that when your father gives you doesn't, you can start on your own. Do you know most of the people who look forward to their father's land are just taking money? Because they don't know how to save their fathers. After all, they have land that they can get from their father. I'm not going to get it. Now, God is saying, for this is a man shall live. He wants you to start your own and learn it yourself. Not like on the other person. And I'm not suggesting it is wrong to get inheritance. I'm saying it is wrong to demand it. And I'm saying it is wrong to wait for it. I'm not going to get it. Why with your own hands? I'm not going to get it. This is what you are talking about, men. This is a man's game. That's why you are only men. You need to understand that. Do you know fathers where they are waiting for inheritance? They have a lot of trouble with their wives. The wife says something, the mother is not saying something different. Who are you going to side with? Your mother. Am I right? Why? Because, and it needs to be understood, because you fear your mother may say something that will make you not get back. The moment you are clear and you tell your parents that you are not waiting for their land, that you tell you, please pray for me. I really want God to give me property. So that whether you give me or not to give me, I want to rely on God. As soon as your father knows you are not waiting for it, he starts treating you like an adult. How many kids? Yeah, because in our country, what they never do, they go home and they say, no, you are not going to be a blanket. Now, our parents are not changing. But the older ones used to answer a blanket. Am I right? So if this one keeps giving the blanket, all the land is given to the blanket. How many kids? So why are you giving yourself into prison? And then it's when you are married. How many kids? Get the principle from the Bible. A man shall leave. You must create a new economic center. Your parents are a different economic center. So don't get married until you are ready to have a separate economic center. And it's an important thing to not realize our time is. You don't have enough time to deal with this. But you can see we are very, very important principles. If your marriage will start, you must work with your own hands and not with other people's hands. The other thing that the next thing this principle is says, be united with his wife, and they become one flesh. In terms of economics, what are we learning? That once you marry, there will be no wife's property, and man's, the two shall become one. Unfortunately, the devil has eaten us to be one in the bed. That's only one aspect. Man is not just physical, he is spiritual, he is social. You have to be one in many ways. And on Sunday, I'll try to deal with this matter. But now we are doing one in economics. This idea of having rich husbands and poor wives is not biblical. The point that two become one. So one cannot be richer than another. You know, a lot of troubles that are coming is because of double economics, two cost centers, two profit centers in the same world. It will not work. You know, some of the things people use are like this. They say the man who looked after capital projects, the wife on revenue projects. Have you heard of that? What happens? When inflation comes, it affects the wife more than the husband, isn't it? So come one day and there is no meat in the house. Say, well, how come there's no meat? It's because your money never buys meat. Now the price has gone. See, if you want to eat meat, start paying for them. Yet, your argument has been, you are saving money to buy clothes. She is the one who produces. If you don't mix your money together, there is no one less. In a Christian marriage, both of them are equally rich or equally poor. When you go hungry, she also goes. When you get rich, you also get rich. And it's an important thing to understand. The two become one means that the things they own belong together. You know, sometimes pastors make me laugh. You hear pastors say, let us come for Brother Nana. He has bought his wife a car. Let me ask you the question. If the money is together, do I have the capacity to buy my wife a car? No. I told you when you produce the money, put it together. If you try to buy the car, he never should decide. It's car property, yes. Let's not buy a. So, we surprise our car, why will that come? If you ever hear someone who surprises his wife with a car, he's not a Christian. Because Christians have become one. Sometimes you take your wife to God and say, I'm surprised it is our land. How did you get the land? You need to understand, on the wedding day, you say that I have given her all. Especially the busy, these are during the month. Do you remember the month? Most of you are wedded. Do you remember the month? I have given all my heart to them. What are you left with? That's why some people don't want Christian weddings. Because in a Christian wedding, you become poor. Because you give. But the fortunate thing is, the wife also says something like that. You got married after me. The wife also says something like that. Yeah. So, in that way, all the problems of the wife is not coming to your home. All the problems of the husband is coming to your home. So, for you to surprise your wife with a plot, and the money is ours, not yours, but ours, it will be first of all you must deal it. And then, buy the plot. So the mother should be saying, let us come and leave. Obviously, you must have. Because on the wedding day, you are there. And you told us, your wife now owns all you own. How do you end up buying her property? You must have first of all have. You need to understand the economics in a family. The two shall become one. Means all your properties now one. I agree that is. I do agree that is. If today my wife wanted to make a big claim, she would go to all her accounts are generally good. She would have. She can go to the accounts, remove all the money, open a new account, and let me pay this. She has a capacity. My friend, she has a capacity. Why doesn't she do it? Because if she does that, I'll report her upstairs. And the Bible says, vengeance says, why? So if your wife decides to steal from you, he will be handled by God himself. I'm not going to get him. Yeah. That's what we are talking about. You take the risk. Not because you trust your wife, but because you trust God. You're the one who said you should put this thing together. But this woman can steal. That's why we are saying you have to be close to God to be able to talk to Him. Then you know very clear that he is one with you. I'm not going to get it. The two shall become one. And not just one in bed, one in ownership. And the pastor's like making us vow in line with us. And you need to understand that's what he asked. Take a risk. Let me ask you this. Let me ask you a question. If you don't want to take the risk of money, how about your children? You sleep with your wife, you get a child. She has congenital diseases that came from the grandmother. They are not being your son. Am I right? The biggest risk is to marry somebody because their disease will enter your son. If you have your son, it's a big risk. Money is easy. If she takes everything, God will give me, can give me a pain. Am I right? But a son, I'll get to my point. So, marriage is a risk, but not a careless risk. You can't do it then. Because God himself is the one telling us to do it, so I hold him responsible. And for this, at 8 or 8 years, I have found he is with her. I'm not communicating. I can give testimony. Yes. But having your property with your wife at the same time, that's not. But of course, if you are not a Christian, please don't put your money together. Because we are not discussing everything, we are discussing all the income. I'm not communicating. Yeah, your wife must be born again and you also must be born. Like you. Because then that's what you see at the moment. Are we together? Yeah, I'm not talking about everybody. I told you, people who are not saved are willing to listen to me to know what Christians think. But I'm not asking you to follow what I am. See, I'm not communicating. Yeah, if you want to get what I'm saying, you must be born again. Then I can assure you that God will tell you to do it. Will protect you. He has protected me. I'm not going to get it. The choice is yours. You have to make up your choice. And it's an important thing to understand as we discuss. It goes on to say that the man and his wife were both naked and felt no shame. Remember, we are following this on money. What does it mean? You cannot have a secret account. You know, a good marriage, both are naked, and nobody feels. You know how there's a joke, you go come, you know, the NBA, every circumcision will come. The other day, we read in the newspaper, when I came to the news, how a woman went to the washing place, you know, this bathroom that outside. She went and looked into the cable, and saw that the husband was not circumcised. She cried and did a very just game. Did you do that too? So I asked myself, how did we have children? And she had never discovered her husband is wrong. Exactly. How do you get children? Tell you, the guy must be coming to the president. I'm not sure. Now, but according to God's word, people that are married have nothing to hide. So once you lock the bedroom door, you don't have to come yourself. There is no secret with your wife. I'm not communicating. That's what the Bible is saying. You need, if you become, if you born a Christian married, you should be stuck naked and happy. She can be stuck naked and happy as long as the door is locked. Are we together? Not just closed, I mean locked. You don't want the children to come. It must be locked. Now, that's all about this about the body. I told you, man, think it's the same thing with economics. Don't get me. A lot of people are getting depressed because they are giving the wife the impression they are still at work and they are doing fine. Have you heard of those stories? Please, when you have a financial crisis, tell your wife, let her know. That's what it means to be naked. When you are being blessed with more money, tell your wife. You need to open up to your wife. I talked like this in another place where I was talking to you. And during question time, a man put up his head and he said, brother, man, I should marry. How can you expect us to tell our wife our salary? I said, what's wrong with it? If you tell me the salary, the whole village will look at you. So I asked them, say, do you marry an adult or a child? You know, you need to be careful. You are not allowed, it's unbiblical to marry children. You must wait until they become. That's why in the Bible we call it atomia, not to make your. Am I communicating? Like, okay. So, for you to marry a child, it's wrong. It's not biblical. You must wait until she's old enough not to go there in the village, the salary of the husband. Am I communicating? So you need to, then he said he was not giving up. Surely, even Abraham did not tell the wife of Abraham. He said, how did you read that? It's in the Bible. When he was going to sacrifice the son, he never told the wife. I was thrown aback because I didn't know if I may be right. I was thrown aback. I was appealing to God to know what to say. That's when I realized. I asked him, please help me. Where does it say that? I told you, if you have a Bible, just check. Where does it say that Abraham never told the wife about sacrificing Isaac? He realized it is nowhere. It's Kikuyu entering into the Bible, you know? It's a Kikuyu. He knows about Canada. So when he's reading the story, he's all adding Kikuyu to the story. I told him to check. There is nothing that tells us that Abraham never told. It's simply the Bible is silent. He may have told her, not told her. So why are you choosing that he never told her? What are you basing it on? How come they came? So you need to understand, since you're supposed to marry an adult, you're supposed to share. This is not the moment. I still remember when I was the school manager for Shell. I remember a contractor coming to my office. And told me, I'm just coming from my office. But now I know you pray. Mr. Nana, I know you pray. I want you to pray for me. I said, what has happened? They have just told me I have cancer. And it seems to have advanced. I'm telling you so that you pray, but make sure you don't tell my wife. I asked him, you think a stranger like me should know, and you actually not? Can you see there's a problem? Because even as I knew, when he's traveling in bed with cancer, would I be there? No. So you need to understand, if you're in a Christian marriage, you must be transparent. You must share. So you cannot have money for a ring. You cannot have secret. You know that's why you go, sometimes you go to the village. You tell your wife I have no money. Then, on the way back, in the petrol station, the car doesn't have enough petrol. You say, wake up, for money. Why? You know when your wife says there's no money, you still have, she still has money. She also knows when you say you have no money, you still have 2,000. So now you put the petrol, believe it, wife has. Once the petrol is finished, the guy comes and says, hey, on the other side. Your wife says, I actually gave my aunt all the money that? Now you don't bother to ask the petrol to move the petrol. That embarrassment is a sign. You don't have a Christian. Why would you tell your wife you have no money when you actually have? You have three problems. One, you could end up in that embarrassment. Two, you are going to hell because you are alive. Three, it means that you cannot plan properly. So you need to understand what the word of God is telling us. If you want a Christian marriage, it means you must be transparent, you must be naked without no shame. And that's what we really have. Now I have to finish. And so, but my notes are with, it's like a talk with all the notes. But let me say four things. Number one, please go to 5 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. If somebody sees the verse, he can read it for me. 5 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. What is the Sunday? The Bible is clear. You must work with your hands. What is work? Work is whatever you do that meets the needs of others. That's what I mean by work. So you must ask yourself, and we talked about that earlier in the week, what in which area has the Lord gifted you that meet the needs of others? Please, that's what it means to work. To work is to meet other people's needs. And what they have in the bill, how am I getting? You will be employed, you will be in business, but it's all about meeting people's needs. So you need to find out which area you gifted in, and other people have need of that area. What are the needs of the people you reach? Or is it zero? Is it zero or limited or zero? Yeah. Now, once you discover it, then you work hard to meet their needs at a price. That's what we mean by work. The issue of being lazy must be. Somebody find it. 4:11-12. Do you stand up and read? We have found it.
The Thessalonians?
5 Thessalonians 4:11-12. It says,
First Thessalonians 4:11-12. Make it your aim to live a quiet life, to mind your own business, and to earn your own living, just as we told you before. In this way, you will win the respect of those who will not believe us. You will not have to depend on anyone for what you need.
Now, read, it's one long sentence. Read the first phrase and the last phrase. Make it your aim. Go to the final phrase.
What you need.
No, not to move. Wait, you talk about.
Make it your aim to depend on anyone.
Not to have to depend
on anyone for what you need.
Are you hearing what the message of the Bible is? Make it your aim not to depend on.
To mind your own.
That sounds wrong, isn't it? It's only in the Bible.
Work with your own.
Elisha, did you read that one?
Work with your own. Because some people work with their uncle's hands. Others work with their wife's hands. You must work with your own hands. And you need to understand that as a man, it's critical. That's why, as a man, when you are made redundant and your profession has no vacancies, you do another job just simply to meet your family's needs. You don't have the luxury of becoming a houseman so that your wife is one provider. These things are happening today, isn't it? So you need to understand, and the issue is, there is always something you can do if you are not proud. Pride is the one that makes an engineer not agree to sell your shop. How can I achieve engineer? How can I? No, whatever can bring income. Is that what you have read? Work with your own hands. So that you do not depend on anyone. Have you read that? So as men, we must decide, even if you lose the job, you can work with your hands, your wife will be earning 100,000. You'll be bringing 10,000. That 10,000 will be enough for kitchen budget. Am I right? So instead, the family will depend on 110 rather than 100. How complicated. The idea of a man who depends on the wife is a contradiction of the scriptures. You need, actually, another verse says, it's a pity you have run out of time. Another verse says, if you don't want, don't eat. That means every time your wife brings you man, you have to ask yourself, where will you go to hell? Because you see, if you eat, you have to obey the Bible. Am I communicating? So to her daddy, I know you love me, that's why you gave me to daddy. But I don't want to go to hell. I'm not eating today. Have that. And the Bible says, if you do nothing, you eat. Am I communicating? It's important to understand. Remember, our topic today is man as a provider. You must use your hands, your brain, even if it's not bringing as big a salary as your wife. You must produce. So the question will be, if you can do it so much, God will give you more. Am I communicating? But the alternative, and many people are doing that, where if they lose their job, say, me, it's a real money giving it. Once you have no job, dignity is secondary. However, I can bring it. Am I communicating? It's not either. It's not ending. You must work with your hands. That's the scriptures. So that you don't depend on. It's a critical thing to understand. So, of course, I can't talk like that when the women are in. That's why we don't talk to the men. That's why men are. But we need to talk to each other. Because a lot of men are too proud to do a job. That's not the one that started the university. So the process is we have more incarcerated, and I know Pastor has come, he has dealt with those cases where we are finding family after family where the wife is a provider and the husband is a dependent. What normally happens? Once you are like that, if your wife suggests something, you beat her. That's what society is about. So a lot of violence in the family is a man trying to pretend he's providing. When he is not, providing. So you be in a fight. You need to understand, it needs to be understood. Remember earlier, we say the Christian.
is produce according to ability. Use according to need. So produce what you can. Even if it's little, produce it.
Then basically, use as a farmer. It is my prayer that as we go through these principles in the scriptures, and I want you to go home and read the passage you have read. First Thessalonians chapter 11 and 12. To see that we are not supposed to depend on others. And it's important to understand. That means if you are living in a house, but your income level has dropped, instead of depending on land, God will send you pocket money like that, what could we move to a cheaper place? Am I communicating? Why would you do that? Because of 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12. You can meet your own needs. Am I communicating? Of course, if the laptop gives you without you asking, that's a different matter. But to be having quarrels with the laptop because they are not providing, you are not tied with a store to that expensive house. If your house rent is now 100,000, move to where it is 20,000. It will release money so that your children can still go to school. Not communicating. But you know, because you are. We are living, one of the biggest problems we are suffering from is inability to live within our means. Inability to live within our means. I don't think a marriage can survive when the man or the woman do not know how to live within their means. And you know, it doesn't matter the money you use. It doesn't matter the salary you get. You can always have. When I left campus nowadays, in the 70s, a climbing salary was about 2,000 shillings. And we lived on it. After all, the housing was really proposed, it was 900 shillings per 900, I was in a 2-bedroom house, so 900 shillings per month. We lived from 2,000. Within one time, as I was getting promotion, I thought they only 20,000. Do you know? My struggles with that 2,000 were similar to my troubles at 20,000. Somehow, I was struggling. Within one time, my salary was 200,000. And I was still struggling. Not communicating. You need to understand, you can live within your means at your salary. You know, when I had 2,000, I used to use matatu from Boroboro to Tab to share with my house. It was 1 shilling and 50 cents. So 3 shillings a day. Those days we used to work on Saturdays for 6 days. Then me myself, I went down. I bought a car. As soon as I bought a car, the petrol that day was 7 shillings and 50 cents. So, till the 10 kilometers there, 10 kilometers back, I started realizing it's amazing 15 to 20 shillings for transport per day. From 3 shillings, it is down to 20. But the salary has not changed. Can you see why I'm still struggling with my debt? So, when you choose to have a car and your money is not enough, the child will pop out to be married so that you put petrol. And nobody can eat, live on petrol. I'm not communicating with you. So living within your means living within whatever it is that you are able to eat. Let me tell you something, just so that you understand. If you, for example, decide to buy a car, you are not after a car, you are after transport. Am I right? Now you can get that transport at different levels. If you buy a VC from Dubai, you might get it for 300,000. You know a bit, and it will take you there. If you can carry 5 people. If you have more money, you can buy a Mercedes, a 10 million. But if you are going to Nakuru, the Vips and the Mercedes will arrive at the same time. Why? A Mercedes has the capacity to drive at 300 kilometers an hour. But the government of Kenya has decided no car allowed no more than 100 kilometers. A bit can go at 150 kilometers an hour. But the government of Kenya, because he said only.
So the beast is one that can have breakfast. The money is. So when you start in front of you, are obedient to the law. When you start in Nairobi, you are in a pool. Only this one is paying back a small loan. 300,000. The other one is paying back about 10. Not complicated. Can you see you can live within your means? But now you want to drive a car.
so that people can see your account. Now you are getting to a big room to impress people who don't even care. I'm not coming to you. The same thing with you. When you are poor, you still must have a balanced diet. You must have starch, all the other things. Starch,
protein.
The other one is called protein, the other one is vitamin. Married? Yeah, let's start with starch. If you are not having a lot of money, just go to the copper, buy this, swallow it in that traditional thing, and put that hunger is richer than your own. It's a more balanced job. Every morning in the college, you go to work strong. Your body has starch. But if you get richer, buy bread. But if you get richer like that, buy vitamins. The only trouble is your cells, your body cells, are not under vitamins. They are under starch. So when the vitamins are the one job, it produces starch. When the body is one job, it produces starch. When the cells are thinking, they are not aware of what to pay. Because you see, what the data is, that's it. They said, you need protein. If you have no money, come to me, go buy and buy a bunya of beans. When you buy them in a lot, it's cheaper. Then, if you boil them properly, they'll give you protein, isn't it? But you get cheaper. If you get richer, buy meat. If you get richer than that, buy chicken. But please remember, when the chicken is what? Produces something called protein. When the bees are swallowed, they produce. The body is not aware anymore. I'm not communicating. So you need to understand the critical thing is you must have to live within your. When God wants you to change the diet, to change the world's food, He'll give you the money. Before then, don't live where you should be in the future. Live where you are. And it will not stop you. So it's a pity we run out of time. But you can see it's a big topic, isn't it? Very huge topic. That because a lot of people are traveling, traveling at all, because they don't know how to live within their means. And you can rest assured, any salary will be enough. The other day I was giving Bibles in Gebera, and I was asking somebody, how much do you get 10,000? And you live on it, yes. In fact, one of them told me he even drinks. Now, how do you put 10,000 and you can have balance to drink? I don't know that. Because many of the people sitting here, once they have 10,000, it's in a person. I'm not communicating. You need to understand you can live within the money you have. And one of the things I left out is you don't just live on it, that's called consuming. You must also save. Saving is a biblical principle where the Bible says you are not as wise as an ant. Give everything you get. You must save for winter. Have you read that in the Bible? So, you suppose think that you start saving when you get more money. No, saving is a principle, just like tithing is a principle. You don't start tithing after you are rich. You tithe whatever the income. Am I right? Similarly, you save whatever the income. And you need to start it right, even if you are under 10,000. Put 100 shillings aside. If you put that 100 shillings aside, in a year, it will be more than 1,000. Why, right? Put it into a bank and it will get an interest. Within 20 years, that's the 100 shillings you have been saving. Because of something called compound interest, will make you a millionaire. Not communicating. So you need the principle of saving. That means when you are budgeting, which is critical, you must put the saving aside. Don't eat everything. In economics, you say you are MPC, you are marginal proposal to consume. Must not be 100%, must not be 1. You must force yourself to save. Don't save when you can, save when you can't. Mathematically, it's a principle. Once you save, don't keep the money in the bank. After all these days, the bank won't give you anything. Put it aside, invest it. And the savings account is even an investment. Mathematically, and we have run out of time because I wanted us to talk about the various methods. You know, Adam, you do not talk about buying treasury bonds. Why? You need a million shillings for a treasury bond. These days, from Kibaki, they plot it 250,000. You can buy a treasury bond at 50,000. You just go to central bank, open a CDS account, Every time you have money, you buy. And you can buy as little as 50,000. When you buy, the interest when the bank are giving you 6% interest, just check my tweet,
treasury bills.
They have about 12-13% when other people, you know, the bank gives you 6%. You don't have to take your money and go and buy treasury bills and earn 12%. You know what the bank do? If you are foolish enough to keep the money in the savings account, they are wise enough to show you how to make the money and she'll give you 6%. Mark money again. And earlier, that was because of the rule. Earlier, we used to give 1%. They're going to get given 1%. Yet, you need to understand investing. Saving is not investment. Savings must happen, but investment is when you put money and you don't eat the investment. You eat the return. And if you want to earn by the time you are older than your children and the investor, you start saving now. You buy a treasury bond like now, sometimes they reach 16%. If you are putting 100,000, it means every year the 100,000 will give you 16,000 shillings. And they pay twice, it will be 880. How about you, my point? And that will be a something they give regularly. And there's no risk unless the government collapses. It's not like lending to a bank which can collapse. Bonds are the country itself lending. I'm not complicating. Then they are called unit trusts. But if I go on like that, it will go too far. However, today we are not allowed to question your time because tomorrow is Saturday and we are going to do big questions there. Has that been useful? Was it important to know economics?
Yes.
Yeah, because we can't really be men who are doing what God wants us to be when we don't think about how to provide for our families. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, in your wisdom, you made man the provider to his family. And yet you have to admit it's trouble. It's a difficult issue. We pray that you will give us wisdom so that we will be able to help our families to realize the goals we have set for them by being good providers. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.